by, the saints are going to be gathered home. What a glorious, glorious, glorious day that's going to be. Praise God. We're going to open up and we're going to take up our Sunday school offering. Robert, if you'll ask God's blessings up on it. Amen. Amen. Well, praise the Lord, everybody. That was a good start, wasn't it? Praise Robert. Go that way, please. I hope y'all enjoy this lesson today. It's on Daniel, the prophet of the ages, and he was truly a mighty, mighty prophet, a mighty man of God. And God used Daniel to reveal the kingdoms of his world, but he also chose the church to reveal his ultimate plan for the ages, which is his heavenly bride. We're going to start off with Daniel 2 and 44. And it says, "And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever." God's kingdom is going to stand forever. We have quite a lengthy reading here in Daniel 2, 1 through 13. But it says, "And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams," plural, "wherewith his spirit was troubled, and his sleep brake from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians, and the astrologers, and the sorcerers, and the Chaldeans, for to show the king his dreams. So they came and stood before the king. And the king said unto them, I have dreamed a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation." Haven't we often dreamed dreams and we'd love to know the interpretation of them? Not just that we overate, but that it was something really from God, and have the interpretation of a real dream from the Lord. "But if you show the dream and the interpretation thereof, you shall receive of me gifts and rewards." I'm sorry, let's look at 5. "The king answered and said to the Chaldean, the thing is gone from me. If you will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation thereof, you shall be cut in pieces, and your house shall be made a dunghill. But if you show the dream and the interpretation thereof, you shall receive of me gifts and rewards and great honor. Therefore, show me the dream and the interpretation thereof." They answered again and said, "Let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation of it." The king answered and said, "I know of a certainty that you would gain the time, because you see the thing is gone from me. But if you will not make known unto me the dream, there is but one decree for you. For you have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me, till the time be changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that you can show me the interpretation thereof." The Chaldeans answered before the king and said, "There is not a man upon the earth that can show the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, lord, nor ruler that asks such thing at any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. And it's a rare thing that the king requireth. And there is none other that can show it before the king." I want us to hear this. "Except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh. For this cause the king was angry and very furious, and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. And the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain." You know, our lesson asked the question, do we believe in the end of the world? I don't believe the world is going to end. the age is going to end, but the world is going to stand, because there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. But nonetheless, there was a report that came out in the Washington Times in 2013, over 3 years ago now. And it says that they took a poll on who believed that it was the end time according to the Bible prophecy. And in this poll, they found that 41% of American adults 18 years and older believes that it is the end time, just as the Bible prophesies. Statistics also reveal something that was interesting of the religious differences. 54% of the Protestants believed that it was the end time. 77% of the evangelicals. But this was interesting. 73% of the Catholics, the Roman Catholics that were interviewed, said we are not living in the end time. I found that pretty interesting. Also in this poll, they took a racially how what the proportions were. 39% of the whites are convinced that we are in the end time. 48% of the Hispanics and 54% black believes that it is the end time. But the thing about it is there is a people out there that needs a hope, that's looking for a hope in this world, because they see the troubles, they see the way this world is going, and they feel a need for help, they feel a need for hope, and they are hungry just for what the message of the book of Daniel brings. And what is the message that the book of Daniel gives to us? Number one, that there is a God, and that God has a plan, and that we can be a part of the plan. You know, have you ever been reading a book and either it's not holding your attention enough, or it's got your suspense so until you can't wait to get to the back of the book, so you flip it over and you end the back of the end of the story? I've done that, and normally it's because it doesn't hold my interest enough for me to read the whole book. But nonetheless, have you ever done that? I'm sure you have if you're a reader. But one thing about it, when we read the book of Daniel, we see that God gave Daniel, the prophet, divine visions. And it allowed him to skip in the story, not just to the restoration of the exile, of which he was a part of, but also God gave him the vision and the ability to skip all the way to the end of human history. Can you imagine what it was like? If you read the book of Daniel, you'll find out that Daniel, when he would receive a vision or whatever, he would be on his face, and maybe an angel would touch him. And when the angel touched him, it says it made him sit up with his knees and his hands on the floor, because he was on his face evidently before God. And the angel would touch him, and then he would arise. He had many supernatural, I believe, visitations of angels. But when we read the book of Daniel, we see something in it, and that is the fact that God is sovereign. We see the sovereignty, and we see the power of God, of how that he can move upon a human world to achieve his glorious end, because God has a plan. We need to remember that God has a plan. Now, Daniel is one of the most studied books that's in the Old Testament, but yet it's one of the least understood, because it does deal with the very last of the last days. When you read Daniel, and I read the book through, it's really interesting. The first six chapters of Daniel, it deals with Daniel and his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and that they were named by the Babylonian king. And we see that it talks about their lives living in Babylonian exile there at that time. Then the next six chapters, it mostly concerns itself with the vision of Daniel. We've been talking in this series about the Hebrew prophets, and we know that how that many of them were taken into exile, but we need to remind ourselves about Daniel and his friends, how that they were taken from Judah into Babylon, and they were young men, and they were taken, if you'll read it, they were taken for a sole purpose, and that purpose was to turn them into Babylonians. In Daniel 1, chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, it says, "And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of the eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel." And listen who he wants. "And of the king's seed, and of the princes, children in whom there was no blemish, but well favored, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had the ability, to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans." He took the very brightest, of the young men, because he wanted to indoctrinate. The goal was to indoctrinate them. The goal was to bring them into the culture of the Babylonian culture, into the pagan ways of Babylon. We see that if they did this, then Nebuchadnezzar, Babylon was growing, and the bureaucracy was growing, and this would give him men of to use in that Babylonian bureaucracy that was needed in the management of it. Also, you think about if you had a child that was taken into captivity into a foreign land. Well, if they were taken into the Middle East, and they were taken for their sole purpose was for the indoctrination and the inculturization of that country to take God, the true God, out of them. Can you imagine what you would feel like as a parent? Well, another thing that this did was it crushed the spirit of the parents that were left in Judah. To think that their sons were there and that they were being taught to do obeisance to Marduk and all of the heathen gods with a little G. And to think also that if this was successful, if it succeeded in one generation, that the memory of Jehovah, the memory of Jehovah, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the teaching that Jehovah was God, he was sovereign, he was the only God, he was the only true and living God. But if they were successful in them, then in doing this, then it would more or less just wipe away all of that teaching, and they would be brought into this Babylonian paganism of worshiping heathen idols. But we can look and we can read the rest of the story in that part, and we can be thankful to God, and we can be thankful that that Daniel and his fellows, the Bible calls them, but his friends, how they stood for God. In Daniel 1 and 8, it says that Daniel purposed in his heart. It was a heart matter. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. He had to make up his mind. Daniel was devoted to Jehovah God and Jehovah God only. He may have been taken into a pagan country. He may have been in the Babylonian there with the rest of the exiles, but he purposed in his heart, I will not be moved. I will not eat the king's meat. I will not drink the king's wine. And so, and that took courage. So we see that the eunuch allowed them to do this, and we all know the story of how they prospered in their health, and they were wiser than all of the other wise men of Babylon. But we see that in Daniel that they decided they would not be conformed. They were not going to be conformed to the Babylonian way of life. But Daniel and his friends did not always have it what we call an easy road. Because you see, they were opposing Nebuchadnezzar. They were opposing the Babylonian paganism. They were opposing their very way of life. But in this, we see that, number one, they met up with danger. They met up with persecution and adversity. Number one, what they said they would eat, they would not eat the king's meat or drink his wine, but what they chose was really just like a starvation diet or rations. So we see that also another way that they were put into danger was, okay, when Nebuchadnezzar, we read, when he could not remember his dream, he said, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to assassinate every one of the prophets. So we see assassination in the wise men of Babylon. Then again, we see when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow down before the image of the king. Now, I want us to put ourselves in that place. You're in captivity. You're in captivity. And there is a ruler that is over you that has the power to take your life, to put you in prison, to do whatsoever he chooses. And they were tyrants. They were tough. Okay, but they got this out of vanity. They have this huge image that is built, and they expect everybody to bow down to this image. Well, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, we're not going to do it. They refused to bow. So what happens? They were cast into the fiery furnace. And you think, would I be strong enough to do that? I think we don't know until we get to that place. I hope I'm never put there, but because I feel like I'm a weakling. But who knows? The grace of God is always there for us. But they refused, so they were thrown into the fiery furnace. Also, even Daniel himself, when he was cast into the den of lions. But in each and everything that they faced, the thing about it was that God, there was a divine intervention every time something took place in their life. You know, Daniel had his dream, but we see that the first dream that's talked about is Nebuchadnezzar's dream, his vision that's recorded. And you think about, why did God give a heathen king a vision of what was going to take place? Why did God do that? Because God is sovereign. But we see that when he has this dream, as I said, he calls for all the magicians and the astrologers and the Chaldeans and all of the wise men of Babylon. And, you know, I've had this dream. Tell me my dream and tell me what it means. And they said, well, we can't do that. I mean, that's known only to the gods. I mean, we can't tell you what you dream. Hey, you tell me what you dream, then we will tell you the interpretation. Well, they could have given him any interpretation, but we see they could not do it because it was not within their power to do it. And that's when he said, I'm going to kill you all. I'm going to cut you up. I'm going to dismember you. And so the decree went out. All of the wise men were to be assassinated, to be killed. But we see this comes to Daniel, and Daniel goes to the king, says, give me some time, and I will tell you your dream, and I will tell you the interpretation of your dream. And so he did so. So Daniel goes to his friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and he tells them the situation. And they pray. They pray. And after they pray, God gave Daniel a dream. And in this dream, he gave him Nebuchadnezzar's dream, and he gave him the interpretation of the dream that he had had. We know that this was not within Daniel's power. This was something that was supernatural. It was a gift of God. It was something that God did for Daniel, because their lives were on the line also. It wasn't just the wise men of Babylon, but it was Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel. Their lives would have been taken also. And, you know, as we read in Daniel, the second chapter, how that the Chaldeans said, you know, King, we can't do this. We can't, I mean, that there's not a man upon the earth, he said, that can show what the king dreamed. He said, it's a rare thing that the king requireth, and there is none other that can show it before the king except the gods, little g, whose dwelling is not with flesh. Well, think about it. Their gods didn't tell them, the little g, God. Their gods could not tell them what the dream was, but yet they had one thing right. It was the God, only the God of heaven, the true God that could give this revelation and could give this dream to the prophet Daniel. So we see he then shows Daniel in the dream, and he goes to the king, Nebuchadnezzar, and he tells him his dream. Would y'all bring up the vision, the statue, please? The dream that Nebuchadnezzar had was of a statue. And in this statue, it was a head of gold. The arms and torso was silver. Then the other was bronze. And it went to, the legs were iron. And the feet were iron and clay mixed. So he sees that. And he says, Nebuchadnezzar, the head of gold, it is you and your empire. And ever since then, man, well, throughout really most of church history, they have seen the statue as what it is portrayed up here. That the first empire, which is true, it is the Babylonian Empire. And then they viewed the silver as the Medo-Persian Empire, then the next one, the Grecian, Roman, and then the revived Roman Empire. Now, that's the way I've always heard it taught. That's what I've always heard, and that the Roman, the clay and the iron of the toes are to be revived in the very last days. Something that they have on our lesson that is not exactly up there, bronze, it said Alexander's. Would that be Alexander? Okay, but we see that there's another interpretation that is gaining prominence and by the contemporary commentators. And they are seeing it a little bit differently. Yes, the head is the gold, and it is Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian Empire. They said the silver is the empire of the Medes, that the bronze is the empire of the Persians, and that the iron is Alexander the Great and his world conquest, and that the iron mixed with clay was of the indication of the division of his empire after his death. Whichever way it may be, I don't know. I don't think any man knows until it comes to pass. But whichever way it may be, we look at that head of gold. Now, we know that gold is of great value. And gold is the beginning of the timeline that Daniel shows and tells the king in this dream. It's the beginning of the timeline of the empires or the kingdoms that are to be. And it is gold. Gold is worth a lot. It's valuable. It's valuable even in our day. Gold is valuable. I mean, we buy a little bitty ring with gold on it. Just say we got some gold, right? But the thing about gold, gold can be hammered. Gold can be pressed permanently out of shape. You can stretch a ring and make it larger when it's made out of gold. You can beat it, you can press it, and it doesn't crack and it doesn't break. It'll keep its shape. It can be beat out of shape, and whatever shape you beat it in, that's what it will be. Okay, that's the beginning of the timeline. Then we're going to go toward the end of the timeline, which was the legs. Now, the legs are made out of iron. Iron is not pretty. Iron is an ugly element, and it doesn't have the value of gold, but it's strong, and it has endurance. Iron has endurance, even though it's worth less. That is, I really believe, the Roman Empire. But nonetheless, we see that these are the powers God was showing Nebuchadnezzar. These are the powers that are going to rule in the earth. We see that also that when he looked and he saw this statue, that it was a power, it was a pattern rather of human domination, and that it was got increasingly ugly. You know, sin is ugly, and the things that you see in people that well, I thought of Hitler, and he wanted an empire. You think of, you know, all the Stalin and the different ones. They wanted to rule. It was ugly. It was ugly what they did. But we see also that with the power that they had, it increased in strength, but yet it diminished in value. I'm going to read us a little something right here out of the book that I thought was pretty horrible. It's talking about the most violent century. It says, while it has been impossible to arrive at accurate counts and estimates by historians very widely, Stalin is thought to have been responsible for the death of 20 million. Lenin, tens of millions in the Soviet Union. Mao's rule resulted in the death of several tens of millions of Chinese. Pol Pot killed 20% of the population of Cambodia. Can you believe that? And that pattern was reflected elsewhere in Southeast Asia, Africa, Eastern Europe, the Balkans, Mexico, Central and South America. And each regime that did this, they did it for power, for greed, and they called it, quote, justice, because that was their teaching. But all of these motives were nothing but something that came out of a religious, well, we're seeing something now that is a religious and a political thing that's taking place with the Middle Easterns. That's not only religious, it is a political thing of what they are doing. But we see nonetheless that he shows him this statue. But the thing about it is, Daniel told him what was going to happen next. It's not like he left the world with that. But this one is a beautiful thing. Daniel 2 and 34. It says, thou sawest. Now here's this huge statue. And then this is what he sees. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This was a stone that was not cut out by the hands of a man. This phrase basically means a boulder. It was a boulder. But this boulder had the ability to grow. And it had the ability to literally pulverize the statue, which are the empires that are to rule. Pulverize the statue until it was like chaff blowing in the wind. And then the boulder began to grow until it filled the earth like a mountain. And then Daniel, he left. He left nothing to go unsaid to tell us what the uncut growing stone represented. You know that stone? I think I remember reading about a stone that the builders rejected, don't you? The chief cornerstone. Daniel 2 and 44 says, "And in the days," this is what he's telling Nebuchadnezzar, "and in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever." What is this coming kingdom? It is the kingdom of God. It is the kingdom of our Christ, of God. And it's something, it's a kingdom that a man did not have anything to do with. It's a kingdom that a man could not have anything to do with. Because this is a divine kingdom. This is where a divine God comes in to a world that is evil, that is full of sin and of degradation. But he comes in and a pure and holy God is going to do away with that evil. Now, it's hard for us to comprehend a place where there's no sin, where there's no evil, where there's no darkness, but it's going to be. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. That's when the will of God is going to be done. That's when this stone that was not cut out with a man's hand, that's going to grow until it just encompasses the whole world, and he's going to rule and reign the kingdom of God. And it's going to be a lasting kingdom. It's going to be a beautiful kingdom, because it's going to be God's kingdom. We see that Daniel's vision in chapter 7. He also has, if you'll show me give me the four beasts, please. Daniel's vision, he had a vision in chapter 7, and it was four beasts. Now, there's been a lot of speculation about the identity of them. And I'm like Brother Zombie, this lesson, all you can do is just kind of skim, take it and run, because you don't have much time. But in this vision, he sees four beasts. He sees like a lion with eagle's wings plucked and later lifted up from the earth, and a man's heart given. He sees a bear raised up on its side, had three ribs in its mouth, and was told to arise and devour much flesh. A leopard with four fowls wings, had four heads, and was given dominion. And this last beast that Daniel saw, it was so ugly and so monstrous that he could not even say what it was like. He said, it's exceedingly dreadful, terrible beast. Iron teeth. And when I read that, I thought about iron teeth. Iron teeth is destructive. Teeth eat. It's destructive. Iron teeth, brass nails, had 10 horns, a little horn, which plucked 3 horns. Now, I'm not going to get into all of that because, number one, I'm not qualified. But I will say this, on the four beasts that he saw, the four beasts, there's been a lot, like I say, a lot of speculation regarding these beasts, but that they are symbolic, and I believe they are symbolic of empires or nations, even in our day today. What is the symbol of America? The eagle. And it says that the eagle's wings were plucked, and they were lifted up upon from the earth, and they were given a man's heart. I think that is America. I believe the eagle's wings, because that is our symbol, the eagle. We broke off from the lion, which is Britain. We broke off from them. Also, the bear. Whose symbol is the bear in our world today? It is Russia. Okay, the leopard. Who is the leopard? It is Germany. And number four, the beast that was so exceedingly bad and had iron teeth that he could not even call out what it could even look like. I think it just shows the evil of that kingdom, the evil of that kingdom. Now, whether or not these four beasts are in sequence with the statue that Nebuchadnezzar saw, some people think that it is. Some people may think that it's not. We don't know whether it's the same as the statue that Nebuchadnezzar saw or not, the same kingdoms. I don't believe they are, because I do believe America is in that. I do believe Britain is in there. I do believe that Russia and Germany, I believe they're all, and they're in our in existence today. They will have something to do. Of course, these are all symbolic. These are symbolic. And they are symbolic of forces that they range against God. They come against God. They come against truth. They come against righteousness. It is, in reality, they all have the Antichrist spirit. And I'm talking about the leaders of the nation. Paul said, the spirit of Antichrist doth already work. And now that was in Paul's day. And sometimes I think now, that was almost 2,000 years ago. If the spirit of the Antichrist worked then, and I believe it did, because they were under Roman dominion. But we see that, how much more would he say that the spirit of the Antichrist is working today? You know, it's almost like, now this is just me. It's almost like that fourth beast, it says, could it be the Antichrist? I don't know. I don't know who it could be. But we know one thing. He's coming. And we know another thing, that God's word is always fulfilled to the nth degree. It will take place just as he said. But we see that when you look at mankind, when you look at man, you see that the nature and result of human desire for conquest, for power, and that's where that evil comes in. They want to be the one with the power. I think of Chavez. When he was in power, he was voted in, but then he just decided he was going to stay in. and he had the power over the nation. But then Chavez died. You know, these rulers need to understand something, and that is that they may have a little power for a little while, but there's a great big God that's got the power all the while. And each one's going to stand in judgment for the things they do. When you think of anyone that could kill 20 million people killed, when you think about how they could practically destroy one-fifth of their whole countrymen, I cannot imagine the evil of the heart. I cannot imagine, quite frankly, the demons that possessed him. If the legions, he said he had legions that Jesus spoke to, and he did nothing like that. Only God knows. But I think what it is, Satan gives them the power to do these things, and they sell their soul to them for that. But that's for all human attempts to self-rule have always ended bad. It's always ended bad. Because it's just like the beast that shows here. They are beastly mockeries of anything that is good and that is holy. But once again, and in closing, we can thank God that this was not the end of the vision that Daniel saw. Daniel 7:13, in closing, it says, "And I saw in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him." Who is him? Anybody out there? Who is him? Does anybody know who him is? Jesus. We're talking about Jesus today. I think everybody's afraid they're going to give the wrong answer. No, we're going to serve Jesus. He's going to be the one that rules and reigns in the millennial reign for 1,000 years. Only Jesus. "He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him, and there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. And his dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed." Praise God. We've got a great big God that's coming. The one that comes is going to come. He's going to come as the Son of Man is going to come. The Son of God is going to come. The crucified Christ that's been glorified. Praise God. That's got that brand new glorified body that's going to come. He's going to come and rule and reign. It's none other than Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory. And you know, we were singing by and by before I got up here. When the morning comes, there's going to be a great morning coming for the church, for those that are faithful to God. And I just thank God that we've got the Word of God that we can look to, and the Word of God gives us hope. Yes, it tells us the things that's going to come to pass, and they're not all going to be pretty. But it tells you one thing: God will give you grace to go through it. And when he gives us grace to go through it, at the end of it, it's going to be worth it all, because we're going to behold the face of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we will rule and reign with him forever, for he is our God. Let's give our God a great big hand clap of worship, for he is God. Glory to the name of Jesus. God bless you. I hope you got something out of this. I will say this was not the easiest lesson to teach, because it was, number one, you had to cram a lot in there, and also it's on prophecy, and there is, I'm not a prophetic teacher. But Lord bless you as we go into our service.